From beautiful downtown Sacramento, it's time for Beach Blanket Fort Bingo.
Beach Blanket Fort Bingo. Beach Blanket.
This episode of Beach Blanket Fort Bingo, we are not going to dive deep into the career of power pop legend Paul Collins. Instead, we're going to talk about something that already dives deep into his career, his brand new autobiography entitled I Don't Fit In, co-written by Chuck Nolan. Now, today I'm joined by my friend and co-host Ronnie Barnett, who some of you may know as the bassist of the Muffs, but most of you should know him as the star of Ronnie Barnett's Boom Boom Room, right here on YouTube. We are joined by the king of power pop himself, Paul Collins, and co-author Chuck Nolan to discuss the book, I Don't Fit In, and the new Paul Collins beat CD, Another World, the best of the archives. Greetings, gentlemen.
Hey, Steve.
Hey, Steve. Now, can you guys see me?
Yeah. Yes. Paul Collins, Another World is available on CD, which I hold. Paul just showed you the vinyl LP.
This is what you got to get.
That is beautiful. That is beautiful.
Gorgeous. And you know what? It's the same color on both sides. Can you believe that?
I have both formats, Paul. I want you to know. I got it on vinyl and CD too. So.
Yeah,
Ronnie, I can only count on you to have everything that has ever been released by anybody.
But if it says Paul Collins on it, I want to own it.
The CD is available through Alive Recordings, which is through Bump. So you can get this easily online. You can get it in stores, the smart record stores that bother carrying great music. But we're going to start here now. Chuck Nolan, a gentleman who co-wrote the book with Paul, we're having some issues, some audio and video issues, so he will join us at some point. But I'm going to start the interview here. Paul, you just released two separate projects that look back at your 40-plus year career. There's the CD and the LP release of Another World and your autobiography. Ronnie, please, this is your time to show the book.
I got it right here.
Okay. Now, Paul, did one of these projects inspire the other, or did they just sort of happen at the same time?
Yeah, it's really a coincidence. They were not planned to come out together at all. They just kind of, the book was really a much longer process when I started it to when it got finished. It took quite a long time. Mm-hmm. And the archive... the archive record was very spontaneous. I mean, basically, you know, I'm sure a lot of you out there have your musicians, especially have these shoe boxes and shopping bags full of cassette tapes that you haul around with you from house to house or apartment to apartment, country to country. And every once in a while you look at it and you go, what am I going to do with all this stuff? I don't even have a cassette player anymore. So when I saw, but I couldn't bring myself to throw out, you know, a 30-year-old cassette that had the nerve scrawled on it or the beat or whatever. I just couldn't throw it out. I couldn't do it. Mm-hmm. So when I saw that Risho cassette capture deck advertised that it would, you know, a couple of years ago when it said, you know, it would automatically digitize your cassettes right into your computer, I knew that's what I had to do.
Let's go. Let's go. Well, you can turn it up now because it's rock and roll. All the kids are dancing now, they're ready to go. once again, thank you. Chuck has worked everything out, and we're raring to go. Now, Paul, you've been doing interviews for over 40 years, telling your many great stories, talking about your many great records. What finally inspired you to write the book, I Don't Fit In? And this is the time for somebody to hold the book up.
I got it right here. Upside down, inside out.
And how did Chuck get involved?
I guess I'll take that one. I've been friends with Todd Novak for a long time, since probably the 90s. And from time to time, he would have book projects on his shelf, and he'd ask me if I'd wanted to do them. And for various reasons, it never worked out. But when this fell in my lap, I was like, that's it. I've got to do it. I was all aboard.
So you didn't know Paul. So Paul, how did you decide to bring in a co-author? How did you hook up with Todd Hozak?
Yeah, I knew I needed someone with some kind of literary background to help me finish this thing. Because it was, you know, as a songwriter, you go, oh yeah, I write songs, I can write a book. And then you start writing a book and you realize that writing songs and writing books have not a lot to do with each other. And so when Todd said, hey, I got this great guy, you know, Chuck Nolan, who will, you know, he's got a journalistic background, and he's totally into rock and roll, and he'll help you, you know, why don't you two guys try to put the manuscript together? I was like, thank God, because I was over my head with, you know what I mean? I had, you know, it's like I had all the stuff, but I didn't know how to mix the record. I needed an engineer to mix it. And mm-hmm. Chuck became the engineer. He also was good at, there were things that Ronnie loves that I would have left out, and that's Chuck. No, if you don't put this in, Ronnie will not buy the book.
What good is one arm without the other? What good is my life without you? How much more must we suffer to realize that it's true? And that's what life is all about. It's the little things that really count. Yeah, that's what life is all about.
Chuck reminded me of something. He's talking about buying the records when he was a kid. The Beat was such an important album for me. I mean, I love all of your work. In fact, Paul, I don't even think you realize this, but I've actually interviewed you a couple times. But it's been either over the phone.
I know that.
Okay.
Of course.
I remember
bringing it up, though.
What was that?
I didn't want to bring it up and embarrass. Okay.
That's okay. Ronnie never brings me up. But I remember that record was so important for me that even when I just see a picture of the album cover, I instantly can smell the inner sleeve right when you sliced it open. And you know, it's such a monumental record for me and so many other people, but I just wanted to throw that in and then Ronnie can continue.
Well, I say something about that?
Yes.
Besides, thank you. And that's very flattering. I think that record is like that because the four guys who made it also have that same feeling about that kind of music.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We mm-hmm. were as much fans and, you know, so dedicated to what we all loved at that time, because that mm-hmm. was, you know, when you were in that kind of music, it was like a like a life declaration. This mm-hmm. is what I believe in, you know, it's almost like a religion, you know, and you had to prove it, you know what I mean? You went out of your way to make that as a statement. And sometimes people would look at you like, you know, what, are you crazy, whatever. No, this is where I think it's at. So yeah. I think that record has that kind of feeling because we also felt that way. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. I think you can throw on any Paul Collins album. We're talking throughout your career and they're all timeless.
Yeah. Great songs don't go out of style.
Yeah.
So getting back to the book, Paul, I'm impressed with the book overall, but
I think I like my copy better than yours, Ronnie.
But you're very honest in this book. Like, you're not afraid to come off like a jerk. I could use another word. I don't know how clean.
You know, use the dirty words.
Your experiences with women and band members and relationships. You're very honest and not afraid to say you've made a few mistakes along the way.
That you know, to tell you the truth, that part came easy. I when it was done, I was like, oh boy, I might have gone too far here. But being that kind of honesty, you know, and when you've had a career like that, it wasn't hard to do. It's like, this is what happened. And
yeah,
I think maybe I had a sixth sense to know that just saying everything was nice and everything was fun and we had a lot of good times would not make an interesting read. And I also think that you can write a book like that when you've had a career like I've had, when it hasn't been like, you know, a piece of cake.
Baby, it's a fine, fine thing that you'll say. I love you.
Chuck, were there passages, even chapters of the book that you maybe had to talk to Paul about to just sort of verify, are you sure you want this in there? Or are there things that you felt uncomfortable to put in there? Or did you just say, just friggin' go for it?
I would be more on the friggin' go for it side, but I'll give you a little bit of background information on that. Paul, one thing when I first read the original manuscript of the book, one thing that I was drawn to was how tough and raunchy it was. It reminded me almost of a Goodfellas kind of narrative starting in, you know, New York and all over the world and his mm-hmm. whole childhood experience and going on to his rough and tumble rock and roll lifestyle. But there were certain things I would point to. There were some things he didn't really want to go into. I noticed probably the two biggest stories that I had to dig a little deep were the Nerves movie chapter and the falling apart of the Case Collins tour. Mm-hmm. And both of these chapters, I'd be on the phone with Paul and I would ask him about it. And he would say, no, I don't think I really want to go there. I don't want to go there. I would give him my pitch. We'd kind of go our separate ways, hang up for a bit. Then I would get a call the next day and Paul would sound, you know, like he was just bursting at the seams wanting to tell me, all right, Chuck, I'm going to tell you now. And I'd be just like, you're talking to a friend. We don't necessarily have to use it. And he'd tell me the whole story and mm-hmm. he was real candid. And then I'd go and I'd chop up our phone conversation and put it together and we bounce it back and forth. And I don't know if, you know, somebody, his girlfriend or a friend read it, but he would come back and he would say, oh, no, we can't do this. We can't do this. But it was always a day later. He'd contemplate it and he'd get back to me and say, let's go for it. And I think he understands the value of a good story. So he's a good storyteller. I think there was a lot of candor that went on with Paul, Mr. Collins.
Well, all that is true, but I will say that one of the biggest things, besides a lot of big things, that Chuck brought to the table in this book, and which makes it for me so complete, is he was such a stickler to get all the dates and everything to line up chronologically. It is airtight, you know. And when you know, I think if all four of us sat down and if you recap your life from beginning to end, yeah, there's areas or eras that are hazy or what happened, what year was that? How could that have been in 82 when you were there in 86, you know? And that was a serious piece of work to get all the dates to line up. And I was very lucky. This is kind of plays into the archive record too. For some reason, and it really wasn't as deliberate as it might look, I just I had all the letters from my Aunt Ethel and ex-girlfriends and stuff. So, and it's amazing. The postmarks held up. I had, you know, France, 1981 or LA or San Francisco or New York. The postmarks were like still there so I could piece it together. Mm-hmm. And that was invaluable because a lot of the stuff, I don't remember where I was. Was I there in 82 or was it 83? I don't know, but I have letters from my mom or my sister or a girlfriend or whatever. And that allowed me to piece it together.
I don't fit in, I try to work it out. I don't fit in, no matter what town I'm in. I don't fit in,
did the project end up taking a lot more time than expected, Chuck, or was it just the opposite?
I think it went about right. I mean, we have our everyday lives, and I'd be unavailable for a few weeks, or Paul would be on tour in Europe or what have you. And, you know, I mean, about a year and a half, I would say, would be a good estimate if you subtract any delays. But no, I mean, it's like cooking a fine recipe. You has to stay in the oven for a little bit, and it has to, probably more importantly, it has to cool down for a while. And I think the results hopefully speak for themselves.
Has Jack Lee read this book that you know of?
Okay, it's, you know, again, you asked me like about telling the truth about everything. So, and addressing what Chuck said, at the end, it went so fast, my head was spinning. All of a sudden, the book was sitting in my hands. You know, like Todd was like, okay, we're done. We're driving down and we're going to pick it up next week. And I go, wait a minute, what about page 16? It's done, man. There's no more page 16. So I got like, I don't know, 30 copies to sell. And which I, you know, put online and I wasn't really thinking much about it. And then I get a PayPal from Jack Lee's daughter, Cynthia Lee, who I've been in touch with over the years, and I see her every now and again. She's a lovely young lady. And she says, oh, I want a copy for my dad. This is it. He's gonna, you know. And so she bought it, she loved it. She gave it to her mom, who I know well, Connie Williams, and she loved it. Jack has gotten it. He was very complimentary. He sent me a text message saying, now you're an author, man. Congratulations. I'm so happy for you. You both. But I know for a fact that he hasn't read it, but he gave his approval.
I'm in the phone booth. There's the one across the hall. If you don't answer, I'll just ring it up the wall. I know she's there, but I just had a call. Don't leave me hanging on the telephone. Don't leave me hanging on the telephone.
Yeah, I just asked because the specter of Jack Lee looms large throughout the book.
Jack Lee is a major player in my life. Yeah, he's a major player, and for all kinds of reasons, and you can read the book to find out why. But he was someone, you know, we all have a handful of people that are major players. It could be teachers or girlfriends or musicians or what, you know, just a major player. I learned a ton from him. Good and bad and all kinds of stuff. It's all in the book. But I would definitely say I'm very happy I knocked on his door in 1974.
Our mission with this episode of Beach Blanket Fort Bingo is to inspire people to buy the book without giving too much away. Now, are there particular incidents in the book that stand out as game changers in your career that you just want to maybe just touch on without giving too much details to inspire the people to buy the book?
Yes. It's 272 pages, which is a heck of a lot more than I thought it was going to be. There's all kinds of amazing, and this is, when my first album came out, they called it eponymous. And I was like, what the hell is that? I thought it was like a bad word. I said, why are they calling my record eponymous? What does it mean? Somebody said, Paul, that's what it means. And then when I got the book and the dedication, or in the beginning, it says all photographs and ephemera. I had no idea what ephemera was. I thought, you have to put that in there. What does that mean? It's going to confuse everybody. No, this is what ephemera is. You have to put it in there. So there, the ephemera, I think, Ronnie, I think you'll back me up on this. It really puts you back in the day big time, right?
Oh yeah, I was going to bring that up. I mean, the book is like a scrapbook of your career as well. I could just arrive on any page virtually and there's, you know, just tons of old flyers and photos. I mean, I really like that you did that approach, and it's all spread out. It's not, you know, pictures in the middle, you know, the pictures go along with the text, you know.
That's a funny story. Chuck, why don't you tell them about how the photos went down?
Well, Paul was really resistant to having so many photos, and he would be, I'd get these phone calls and it'd be, Chuck, my God, it's like a, it's a picture book. I want 200 pages and in the middle, 10 black and white photos, like a normal book. I want this to look like literature, and you know, I would.
Like a Lauren Bacall biography.
Todd and I are fans, you know, we're loving all this. We knew you guys would want to see it too. And I mean, it's like a, you know, a Nerves Paul Collins museum, if you want. And I knew it was the right thing to do. And I guess I could just imagine by looking, because on the PDFs, it did not look as impressive as when you hold it in your hand. But, oh, I was so happy when I get a phone call when Paul finally got his in the mail. And he's like, Chuck, oh, my God, it looks so much better in person. It's, you guys were right. This is great. And so it all ended up working out.
Now this is a collection of essentially cassette demos, cassette recordings, things that remain unreleased. Did you go through this and then think to yourself,
wait a minute, just because I don't want to say this myself, it is cassette recordings. Tell the people about the sound quality.
I was thinking it was going to be just like a bunch of like quivering, you know, how, you know, you listen to the old tapes and stuff like that. But the hi-fi to me is really good. It's not stereo, it's not this, you know, it's not 5.1 surround sound, but it's raw and it's full of that excitement and energy from those days. It's full of the excitement and energy that real rock and roll brings.
And it has that touch of compression that cassettes bring that I just adore.
It hangs together well as a listen. You know, it's not like you're like, oh, this is shoddy quality and the next track is, you know, it actually fits together as a listen very well, you know.
Now, were there songs you heard on this, Paul, that you said, how come I never use that? How come I just abandoned
it? There were a couple of songs that I didn't even remember, like No Faith and No Religion. And when I heard it, I remembered it, but I had forgotten all about it. And I got to tell you, I think it's my, you know, obviously the Beats first album is one of my all-time favorite records, but this is going to go down as one of my all-time favorite records. I just love every song. To me, has the magic, which is what we're always looking for in recordings. And I know if they gave me $100,000, I could not go into a studio and give you better versions of those songs. So I'm just so, so happy. It's got my brother on it. It's got Steve on it. It's got Rick Wagner on it. It's got Prairie Prince on it. It's got Billy Thicke on it. It's got all these great musicians. And to me, every song just, it works, you know.
So it captures the time. I like the rawness of it, the roughness of it, because it sounds real. It sounds honest. And
to tell you the truth, Another World is, I think, one of the best songs I've ever written. And I love it. And I think it's perfect for the times we live in now.
We have volume two coming, Paul. Obviously, you could do I'm sure you have a lot more cassettes, right?
Volume two are going to be these cassettes that you send me.
There you go. Okay. Paul Collins, Ronnie Barnett record is on the way.
Now that the book is available, Paul and Chuck, are you happy with the reaction to it so far?
Absolutely. Here I am on TV with Ronnie of the Muffs, and the Muffs, actually, I got to give you guys some props, because that was the first time I ever heard Rock and Roll Girl. I didn't have the album back in 81, 82. And I heard the cover on the Freedom of Choice CD charity compilation. And I'm like, this is just such a great song. Who wrote it? And I went back and did the research and found out about the Nerves and bought the records and kind of got into it that way. So thanks, wow. Ronnie.
Wow. Thanks, Chuck. I just want to say when we did that, that's one of the first things we did. One of the first things that we ever put out. And Kim wanted to change the lyric to, I want to beat up a rock and roll girl.
And she did.
But it was for a compilation about Planned Parenthood. So they rejected that. But and then we got to do, Kim got to sing that with Paul and the beat.
I have
Maxwell's.
A video of that. I will send that to you. It's a great video. And she looks so lovely and sweet. And it's hysterical. And the crowd's going nuts. At Maxwell's, right?
Yes, with Maxwell's. Dream come true. We got to play with Paul on the beat. And then, Kim, watching Kim sing that song with you, Paul, that was a childhood dream of mine. You know, I saw the beat on the Jam Tour, Paul. I don't know if you know that. Houston, Texas.
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah. Houston, Texas, Agora Ballroom. I was there.
Oh, wow.
And a fantastic show. And you guys got a great response from the crowd, too. That was crowd was a tough jam crowd.
That was a very tough tour for us, and it was an eye-opener. Unfortunately, I saw the Jam's first show at the Whiskey to Go-Go, whatever year it was, and we were like, you know, when you go and see, you're a musician, you go and see another band, you go, oh, it's like seeing the Beatles, like, all right, forget it, I'm never gonna be that good, give it up, man. I saw the show in LA and they were literally on fire. It was unreal how good they were. So I was so excited to tour with them, but unfortunately they're not the friendliest guys. And it was really it was an eye opener, and it was just a tough tour because they didn't want to know us from Adam. We never talked to them. And I was like, wow, why? What's up? You know, but that's the way they were.
I was surprised to see the tour fell apart after basically I saw you in Houston.
That was one of the last shows. What happened was they were not happy with the reception they were getting. They were not happy with the way their record company was treating them or performing for them. And their single went number one in Europe, and they left overnight. They got on a Concorde and they went home.
It's just too bad you're leaving. It's too bad you're leaving me. And you've got to say goodbye. Can't believe the reason. Can't believe the reason, girl. Why you say our love's dying.
Does it feel good, Paul, to know that you're putting out better albums than Paul Weller?
Well, I'm not going to step in that one. I'm just I'm a guy that's just very happy that I was able to do what I have been able to do. And now more so than ever. I mean, there was a long period of time, obviously, when I wanted a lot more success than I had, especially in the 90s. And it was very hard. And I was, you know, very envious of other artists' success and not wondering why I couldn't, you know, it's all about the work, right, Ronnie? It's about working. You want to work. You want
to,
you don't want to play dives. You want to play decent clubs. You want to have a real dressing room. You want to have a real stage. And, you know, you don't drive 8 hours, which I've done 1,000 times, and I'm sure Ronnie and a lot of us have done, to make $200 or $300. That's hard work, okay? It's in the, if you're 18, it's fun. Yeah, well, you get drunk, you sleep on somebody's floor. But when you're 25, 35, 45, 55, it's not.
Where can viewers find information about how to get the book?
You can go on my website, www.thepaulcollinsbeat.com. You can go on hozakrecords.com. You can just put I Don't Fit In by Paul Collins in any Google search. I mean, let's face it. It's pretty easy to find.
I'd like to thank everybody for viewing this episode of Beach Blanket Fort Bingo. I would like to thank Paul Collins. I would like to thank Chuck Nolan. And I'd like to thank my co-host and friend, Mr. Ronnie Barnett. You can catch him on episodes of Ronnie Barnett's Boom Boom Room. Chuck and Paul, if you have not watched that, you really should.
We will. Yes. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you, Ronnie. Ultimate. And Chuck, ultimate rock and roll collectors, disseminators of great stuff, keeping this alive for all the kids. Very important.
I know. Yes. I love book events, and I just wanted to have a book event for this great book, Paul. And I'm proud of you, and you too, Chuck. And it's a great piece of work here.
Thank you. Well, your word counts, Ronnie. People know that you don't do any BS.
Ah, Thanks, Bud. I've tried to harbor that image. Thanks for noticing.
Yeah, he obviously doesn't know you very well. All right, thanks, guys. Thank you, everybody. We'll see you next time on Beach Blanket Fort Bingo.
Stay safe.
Seeing you guys.